him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I said,
I love to praise His name.
Oh, hallelujah.
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 Well,
I love to praise His name.
Whoa. You ought to praise Him while you got a chance. I love, 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 I love to praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him. I love to praise Him.
I love to praise His holy name.
Those who can stand, will you please stand? And we pay tribute to Black History Month by singing Lift Every Voice and Sing. Thank you.
Good first Sunday morning, Ariel Bowen United Methodist Church.
Good morning.
My name is Shamika Claire, and I will be your worship leader for today. This is Mikael, and he will be my assistant this morning.
Amen.
Yeah. Your call to worship is listed in your bulletin, your program. And if you're worshiping from home with us today, then it should be displayed on your screen. Praise the Lord. Blessed are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in God's commandments.
Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed.
Wealth and riches are in their house, and their righteousness endures forever.
They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous.
It is well with those who deal generously and lead, who conduct their affairs with justice.
For the righteous shall never be moved. They will be remembered forever.
For the righteous shall never be removed. They will be remembered forever.
They are not afraid
of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, trusting in the Lord.
When they see
their adversaries, their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid.
They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honor.
The wicked see it and are angry. They gnash their teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked comes to nothing.
Amen.
Amen. Father, we declare that we love you. Thank you that you have made the way of love known through our Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would reveal this great love to us all today as we gather here in worship. Lead us by your Spirit to praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We welcome you here, whether worshiping online or in person, to worship with us today. We're so glad that you've joined us as we kick off Black History Month in the month of February, as well as we will be beginning our Lent season and our Daniel fast this month. It's also the month of love. We're going to celebrate Valentine's Day and celebrate loved ones. So we're glad you're here. And thank you for worshiping with us today.
Amen.
Morning, very well, very well.
can I hinder me? No man can I hinder me? No man can I hinder me? No man can I hinder me? Right on, King Jesus. No man can I hinder me? Right on, King Jesus. Right on. No man can I hinder me? No man can I hinder me? Right on, King Jesus. No man can I hinder me?
Scripture, and our scripture today comes from Matthew chapter 5 verses 13 through 20. This is actually one of my favorite verses, so I'll preface it with "Be salty." You are the salt of the earth. I'm sorry, please stand for the reading of the gospel. Give my mind. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly, I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one little will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
It is now prayer time. And if you are comfortable, we welcome you now to come to the altar for prayer. Let's thank God that COVID is in a place that we can now actually come to the altar and gather together closer to one another. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today, humbled, grateful, that you and your mercy are still with us, are still blessing us, and are still loving us. We want to start off by saying thank you. Thank you just for everything that you do for us on a daily basis. Thank you for being with us, for providing for us, and to never, ever, and for never breaking your promises. We thank you for being God and for loving us. Loving us in our bad times and loving us in our good times. Thank you for the food that we eat, the roofs over our head, the beds that we sleep in every night. Thank you for this church that you've given us to even come and worship in, God. Thank you for everything. We are truly grateful for your love. God, I want to pray today for everyone whose heart is heavy, who may be dealing with something, God. I want to pray for those who have a big decision to make, and they may be stumbling on which way to go. God, give them discernment. Give them discretion. Give them wisdom. And most of all, give them your will, God. Let them know your will for their life, for their decision, and for their path. God, I want to pray as we enter into February, the month of February, the month of love, the month of Black history, and the month that we will start our Lent season. And God, I want to say a prayer for the recent losses that we may have endured, God. I especially want to say a prayer for the family of Tyree Nichols. Please go with his family, God. Be with him. Be with his mother, his grandmother, his father. Be with the city of Memphis, God, as they have to deal with this hard loss and the issues surrounding their police force, God. It's always sad to see such a young person go so young, and also sad to see that the cause of his death was five other Black men. And in 2023, to still have police brutality an issue, God, is something that we have to pray for. And so, God, I ask you to also be with and bless the five police officers that did this heinous crime and this murder. Be with them, God. Let them know that you are still there and that they can ask for forgiveness for their sin. And I also pray for their families, God. And God, help us, help your church as we continue to go through these types of these issues, these traumas, to our community, our Black community, and be with the leaders, the government officials, the churches, both here in Atlanta and in Memphis, as they have to face these challenges every day. Help us to understand when dark things like this happen, and help us to continue to fight and serve your community and your people. God, I also want to say a prayer for all the people under my sound, under the sound of my voice. I want to say a prayer for Ariel Bowen and United Methodist Church. Please bless us and help us to continue to do your works in the Pittsburgh community and in the surrounding Atlanta community as a whole. Help us to make a difference in your name and under your will. In Jesus' name, I pray all of these things. Amen.
'Tis the old ship of Zion. 'Tis the old ship of Zion. 'Tis the old ship of Zion. Get on board.
Get on board. Get on.
Many a thousand, it has landed. Many a thousand, it has landed. Many a thousand, get on board.
Get on board.
Ain't no danger in the water, ain't no danger in the water, ain't no danger in the water.
Get on board, get on board.
It was good for my dear mother. It was good for my dear mother. It was good for my dear mother.
Get on board. Get on board.
It was good for my dear father. It was good for my dear father. It was good for my dear father.
Get on board. Get on board.
It will take you home to glory. It will take you home to glory. It will take you home to glory.
Get on board. Get on board. Amen, amen.
Now we will be having a Black History Moment by Mallory. Please welcome her. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
This is our Black History Moment, and I have a question for us today. Who are we? This is interactive.
Well,
yes. Who are we? Amen. And?
Great people.
Great people. So I have a timeline set up for us. And this is the legacy of our church. In 1882, our church started off as a Sunday school. Mm-hmm. Ariel Bowen United Methodist Church began as a Sunday school in Atlanta, Georgia, Pittsburgh Community Home. So somewhere around here in our neighborhood, yes, we started. The first pastor came to preach in 1890. Two bush-covered lots were cleared and a bush arbor was constructed,
Gate City Methodist Church was directed under the Reverend H.M. White. So we renamed the church in 1904 after Mrs. Ariel Serena Hodge Bowen, an active member in the church in Atlanta community. She was a educator, musician, and social reformer. And now, to present day, we have a legacy. Ariel Bowen has had a rich history of serving the Pittsburgh community for 139 years. This is reflected by the prestigious Phoenix Award. So now I'll talk a little bit more about Mrs. Ariel Serena Bowen. So, Mrs. Ariel Serena Hedges Bowen was born March 3rd in 1863 in Newark, New Jersey. She was born to a mother of the oldest Presbyterian church, family in the state of New Jersey, and to a Presbyterian clergy father. The family moved to Pittsburgh, later on to Baltimore, where she graduated with honors in 1885. Soon after, she took the teacher's course and examination and passed. From there, she was called to teach history and English language at Tuskegee Institute, where she read Greek, Latin, and German. In 1886, she married the Dr. J.W.E. Bowen of the Gamma Theological Seminary in Atlanta, Georgia. There, she became a life member of the Women's Foreign Ministry Society of Methodist Episcopal Church, and they raised four children together. Mrs. Hodges was a professor at Clark University in 1895, where she was writing music and began accomplished vocalist and musician with piano and the pipe organ. She was regarded as one of the foremost and best cultured women of her race. So now we'll say a prayer for the starting of Black History Month. Compassionate God, who sent Jesus Christ to deliver us from all manners of injustice and inequalities, create in us new hearts and enlarge visions to see the image of God in every person, irrespective of background and race. May we be generous in our love of others as we work towards ending racism and injustice, creating communities of humans flourishing through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is living and reliance with all of us in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, indeed. That was very interesting. I didn't even know some of that history myself about the church. Now it is offering time, Ariel Bowen.
Amen.
If you did not pick it up, definitely pick it up after service today. But there is a nice little card for you on our three ways to give here at Ariel Bowen. It's outside the sanctuary. The first way to give, and probably the easiest, is online. And all you have to do is visit arielbowenumc.org and hit the blue donate button. And it will take you to a page where you can give your donation. You can actually do it right here in church on your phones. If you pull up your webpage and type in www.arielbowenumc.org, it'll take you right there. The second way to give is also here in worship service, just by dropping your donation in the tithe box here at the front. The third way to give is by mail. You can mail your donation to 384 Arthur Street, Atlanta, Georgia, 30310. And we thank you for all of your generosity and your gifts to the church.
Thank you.
Jesus. Do me like the Lord. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He's my friend. Pick me up. Turn me around. Pick me up. Turn me around. Pick me up. Turn me around. He my friend. Can't nobody told me to run on. Heal my body. Told me to run on. Heal my body. Told me to run on. He's my friend.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody heal me like Jesus.
Can't nobody treat me
like Jesus.
Can't nobody bless me like Jesus.
Nobody, nobody, nobody.
Nobody, nobody.
No, nobody, no, nobody, no, nobody. No, nobody, no, nobody. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He's my friend. He's my friend. He's my
the church say amen. Church say amen again. Church say amen yet again. Let's give God a hand clap of praise this morning. Let's thank him. It is such a joy just to be here today, and we just thank our praise team. We thank our musicians. Let's give them a round of applause. We thank our worship leader, and we thank her helper this morning. It's just good to see you. You know what? It doesn't bother me. You know, because we need more children in the life of the church. If you don't have children in the church, we're in trouble. I don't care what they do. They can climb up on the altar if they want to, but just to have some children in the life of the church, let's give Michael a round of applause. We thank God. We thank God for children in the life of our church. Thank God for Sister Mallory, who did our Black History presentation today, and we'll be having presentations throughout this month. So we look forward to those educational. Serena Bowen was, I think it's only two churches, United Methodist churches anyway, in the nation that is named after a female. And so that's kind of a milestone for Ariel Bowen United Methodist Church. Since it is Black History Month, I know we've been singing some of the old songs. We're going to go back to one of these old songs from the old school. I want y'all to help me a little bit with it. Just one or two verses. Come and go to that land. Come and go to that land. Come and go to that land where I'm bound, where I'm bound. Come and go to that land. Come and go to that land, come and go to that land where I'm bound. I've got a Savior in that land. I've got a Savior in that land. I've got a Savior in that land where I'm bound, where I'm bound. I've got a Savior in that land. I've got a Savior in that land. I've got a Savior in that land where I'm bound. give God some praise. As we all know, February is designated as Black History Month, and it is in the month of February that Black folk in America chronicle the struggles we encountered during our stay here in the United States. It chronicles our journey from slavery to freedom. It chronicles our journey from the plantation to the penthouse and even to the White House. It chronicles our journey from the cotton fields to political candidates and to truly fulfill the memorable phrase that those who once picked cotton can now pick presidents. When we look back upon our tedious journey, we are assured that God was with us throughout the weary years, and God was with us throughout our silent tears. For surely we can say that he has brought us thus far along this journey. As we continue to dwell on the thought of sorrow today, let us turn our attention to the book of Exodus. The word Exodus suggests something or somebody going out of or making an exit or leaving. And as we examine the book of Exodus, we find the chief event recorded in this book is the children of Israel going out of Egypt. The book of Exodus begins with the death of Joseph, the ultimate enslavement of Israel. It ends with the mass migration of the children of Israel out of Egypt, headed towards the promised land. The events in the book of Exodus lie at the very center of the faith of the children of Israel. The book of Exodus records the great deeds of God that brought a people into existence. The events in the book of Exodus somehow shape our understanding of the righteousness of God, for an almighty and an all-powerful God acted in order to deliver and save a weak and oppressed and a poor people. God did not distribute his justice and mercy according to social status, but he looked past trivial things and he saw their needs. Book of Exodus gives rise to the many ways that we have come to know God as a redeemer, as a savior, as a deliverer, as a divine guide, as a rock in a weary land. The book of Exodus starts with the death of Joseph. Joseph, son of Jacob, had been sold into slavery there in Egypt. But while in Egypt, Joseph captured the heart and the imagination of Pharaoh, and Joseph became Pharaoh's right-hand man, put in charge of all of the property and possessions of Pharaoh. And as a result of Pharaoh's deep love and respect and trust for Joseph, he allowed Joseph's offsprings and his family to settle in a region just below Egypt. During the years after Joseph's death, his brothers and his sisters, the children of Israel, began to multiply in number. Their population began to grow at a rapid rate. They began to multiply so fast that they soon began to outnumber the Egyptians. Eventually, they were regarded as a threat to the security of Egypt, and the Egyptians became anxious and felt that they would grow so large that one day they would look to overthrow them and outnumber them. And also in the course of time, Pharaoh died, and another king sat on the throne of Israel, of Egypt, and this king did not know Joseph. This new Pharaoh, fearful of the potential threat from the children of Israel, decided to enslave the Israelites. Children of Israel were made the national slaves of Egypt. They were subject to toil and labor in the fields. They were subject to harsh and cruel treatment from brutal and inhumane overseers. They were treated with bitterness and cruelty, hatred and disdain, disrespect and ungodliness, and relegated to a degrading status in life. They were severely punished for no reason at all. They were stepped on. They were trampled on. They were walked on. They were spat on. They were abused. They were despitefully used. And naturally, the children of Israel began to cry out for the rescue from their miserable plight in life. They began to cry out to the Lord, Lord, to deliver them from the hands of their oppressors. Scripture lesson will come from the book of Exodus, the third chapter. Now I'll read for you from the 7th through the 12 verses. Listen to the words of Almighty God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good land, a broad land, a land that would be flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. For the cry of Israel has now come to me, and I also have seen the Egyptians oppress them. So come, and I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people out of Egypt. But I want to concentrate on that seventh verse. It says, I have observed the misery of my people, and I have heard their cry. I'm going to talk to you very briefly today from the topic, the Lord heard my cry. There's no greater tragedy for a people to be taken captive against their will. Countless events have been recorded throughout the pages of history about people who have invaded, people who have enslaved and oppressed others who were weaker than they were. The mighty Roman Empire enslaved all of their vassals and conquered lands. The continent of Africa, we all know, was stripped and robbed of its population in search of slave labor. The Jewish people still recall bitter memories of the Holocaust and their imprisonment and degradation and forced captivity in German concentration camps. Moreover, in America, black folk are continually haunted by the memory of a little over 400 years ago, we too found ourselves suffering the bonds of slavery. Only about 400 years ago, we were uprooted from our African homelands, tied in chains at the bottom of ships. We were herded like cattle to work toil and till on strange plantations. Just about 400 years ago, we were held bondage, stripped of our God-given freedom, and bound to a sinful system of servitude by ungodly and unrighteous people. Just about 400 years ago, we endured the heat of the scorching sun. We felt the sting of the slave master's whip. We evaded the depth and terror of the lynch mob's noose. We found ourselves captive in a strange land, brutally beaten, separated from our families, treated like animals, bound by pity and bound by suffering, bound by pain and bound by sorrow. And out of our misery and out of our sorrow of this wretched existence, we began to cry out to the Lord. Why me, Lord? Out of our pain and out of our sorrow, we began to cry out to the Lord, Lord, help me to hold out until my change shall come. This is what was going on with the children of Israel. Their stay in Egypt led them into slavery under the hard and cruel heart of Pharaoh. They were subject to hard and unjust labor. They were beaten and whipped unmercifully. The children of Israel were bound to a system of moral corruption. They were chained to a life of unjust servitude by sinful and ungodly people. The children of Israel found that their shackles tied them to a heavy burden. They were robbed of their human dignity, suffered painfully, worked long and harsh hours, starved to death, murdered, beaten, chastised, mocked, degraded, low-rated, and hated. And out of their misery, they began to cry out to the Lord. They began to cry out of the pain and suffering that they experienced. They began to cry out of the agony they felt down in their souls. They began to cry out of their riches, misery. And I can hear them right now out in the hot, scorching sun. Maybe they might be saying, pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry, wild on others, thou art calling. Do not pass me by. Throughout the pages of history, African Americans know all too well the pain of slavery, the pain of racism, the pain of degradation. Young mothers experience the pain of 9 months of pregnancy only to have a newborn baby wrestled from their arms to sold into captivity. We know the pain of racism and racist laws that robbed us of our human dignity, stripped us of our God-given rights. Our old men knew the humiliation and how they were degraded when no matter how old they were, white folk would still call them boy. Our African-American history is a documentation of the pain and suffering of an oppressed people bound by the shackles of human immorality. We know the pain of bigotry and racism. We know the pain of a wicked system of segregation where everything was separate but unequal. We know the pain of a government that denied us the right of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We know all too well the pain of those folk who marched in the streets with Bibles in their hands under the banner of God's children, where all God's children were created equal, only to be met by police billy clubs, only to be met by attack dogs, only to be met by high-powered fire hoses, only to be met by
where their churches were bombed, their little girls were murdered, their leaders were being shot down in broad daylight. We know the pain. Paul Laurence Dunbar once wrote a poem called Sympathy. The inspiration of this poem came from an experience of a tiny bird. Paul Laurence Dunbar began to ask the question, why does the caged bird sing? He observed a bird that had been taken from the forest and put into a tiny cage. This bird was once a free creature, able to go out and fly throughout God's universe. This bird was able to go anywhere that it pleased throughout the forest. It was able to fly high up in the trees or up on the mountain peaks. But now this tiny bird was caged and confined to a much smaller area bound by these steel bars. And now this tiny bird was caged. It could no longer fly throughout the bright sunshine. Tiny bird began to feel the soft breeze in the wind and knew that it would not be able to glide freely in the wind. Began to hear the other birds singing freely in the trees and knew that it would not be able to join his friend. The tiny bird began to beat his wings against the steel bars of that cage. The tiny bird desperately tried to free itself. It began to beat and 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 to beat his tiny wings against the cage until blood began dipping down his bruised wings. The wings were so bruised and his bosom was so sore. His soul was so weary with that when he could not beat any longer, the tiny bird began to fall faint there in the cage and chirp out a song. But the song that the mighty bird began to chirp was not a song of joy. The song that this bird began to sing was not a song of happiness. It was not a song of glee. It wasn't not a song of rejoicing, but the song was a deep and sad prayer that had been aimed up to heaven. I can imagine that the tiny bird might have been saying, do Lord, do Lord, do Lord, remember me. I know that there were some times in the lives of our ancestors that they felt that they were caged in. I know that they felt that there was no end in sight. I can imagine that they felt that there was no hope for tomorrow. I can imagine that they felt bound and shackled and chained and imprisoned by a heavy burden. When you feel they are downtrodden or when you feel helpless, you feel that there's no relief in sight. Nobody that you can talk to. Nobody understands your sorrow. No relief. And I know that they must have understood what the songwriter meant when he said, nobody knows the troubles that I see. Children of Israel were bound in Egypt. God summoned Moses. Amid their trials and their tribulations, God began to seek out a man by the name of Moses. Amid their pain and their agony, God called Moses. Amid their suffering, their cruel captivity, their harsh existence under the hands of Pharaoh, God called Moses out of the desert and summoned him unto a burning bush. What did God want with Moses? What did God call Moses out to do? What did God have to say to Moses through that burning bush? What did God have to say to Moses that was somehow a benefit to the children of Israel? What did God have to say to Moses that could somehow soothe the suffering of the children of Israel? What did God have to say that would somehow lift the burdens and the hardships of those who suffer? God spoke to Moses through the burning bush to assure him that God knew what was going on there in Egypt. The Lord said to Moses, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt, and I have heard their outcry. I have taken heed of their suffering, and I have come down to rescue them. God called Moses to let him know that he was aware that his people were suffering. God knew all about their sorrows. God knew all about their trials and their tribulations. God knew about their pain of his people that they experienced there in Egypt. And furthermore, God told Moses that time has come for me to do something about it. God said that it's time has come for me to deliver my people out of bondage. It has been time has come to tell Pharaoh that he's got to let God's people go. Scriptures are telling us that if there is sorrow in your life, then God knows all about it. God knew the weight of human suffering upon our souls. God knew that Frederick Douglass had grown weary of slavery. God knew about Harriet Tubman's turbulent travels on the Underground Railroad. God knew how heavy the veil of ignorance that Booker T. Washington had to lift from the minds of black people. God knew that Rosa Parks had grown tired of riding on the back of the bus. God knew that Mary McLeod Bethune did not have the money to educate black minds. God knew the troubles Benjamin Elijah Mays was trying to light a candle in the dark. God knew of W.E.B. Du Bois's deep contemplation of the souls of black folk. God knew that King grew weary of marching. God knew Malcolm struggled with trying to figure out what means are really necessary. God knew what happened to John Lewis on the Edmund Pettus Bridge. I've come to let you know that if there's agony in your life, God knows all about it. If there's pain in your life, God knows about it. If there's trouble in your life, God knows about it. If there's grief in your life, God knows about it. If there's sickness in your life, God knows about it. If there are heartaches in your life, God knows about it. If there's depression, God knows about it. If there's hurt in your life, God knows about it. Nobody knows the troubles I see. Nobody knows them like Jesus. Somebody said it a little bit differently. They said, why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should I feel lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my portion? A constant friend is he. His eyes are on a little sparrow. And I know that he watches over me. There's a story told of a poor woman who had several children. Times were hard for this woman. She struggled to provide for her family. Several years earlier, lost her husband and was left to raise five kids all by herself. In order to make money for her family, she would get up early every morning and go out into the fields and she would pick cotton. I don't know if any of y'all know anything about picking cotton. I know we got a few in here, a couple in here. After work, she would always stop by the rich neighborhood to pick up a basket full of clothes that she would wash and she would iron. And when she returned home late in the afternoon, she had to cook and clean for her own family, wash and iron for others, spend many of her Saturdays cleaning houses on the other side of the tracks, and the houses that she cleaned on the other side of the tracks, she wasn't good enough to knock on the front door and go in, but she had to go around to the back door. Despite of hard work, she never seemed to make ends meet, and no matter how hard she tried, she never seemed to make enough money. She was tired, she was weary, but she kept on working. One day while she was there in the field, she received a message from a friend that her son had gotten in trouble and her son that was supposed to be in school was now in the custody of the authorities and she had to leave work and Lord knows she needed every dime that she could and she had to take the little bit of money that she had scrapped up and to pay bills and she had to use that money to free her son and it seemed like he had been hanging out with the wrong crowd and as they walked home she never said a mumbling word, but in her silence, this young boy could see the hardship on his mother's face. He could see the pain and the agony that his mother suffered, and I suppose he began to think long and hard about how his mother, all that his mother did to make sure that food was on the table. He began to think about all the things his mother did to make sure that there was a roof over their heads. He began to think about all the things that his mother did to make sure that clothes were on his back, and that night while his mother was lying in bed and he was there getting ready for bed and he began to feel sorry for what he had done and he decided that he would go in and that he was going to talk to mama. He was going to console mama and tell mama how sorry he was. But when he peeped through the door where his mother was there ironing, and I don't know if I've got a few folk that know about those old cast iron irons. They didn't have electrical appliances. And they had those old cast iron irons, and they would take that old cast iron iron, and they would place it down by the fireplace and allow it to get hot. And while they were ironing, they would have a bowl of water, and they would take their hands, and they would dip it in the bowl of water and sprinkle that water across the shirt or the garment that they were ironing. But the little boy looked down, and he saw that his mother did not have a bowl of water and began to look in his mother's eyes. And when he looked in his mother's eyes, he could see the tears swelling up in his mother's eyes, and the tears that swelled up in his mother's eyes began to roll down his mother's cheek. And as those tears rolled down his mother's cheek, they began to drip down on top of the shirt that she was ironing. She was ironing and working out of the pain and the misery that she had down in her heart. And the little boy heard her praying as she was there working. And the prayer went a little bit like this. He said, "Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on and let me stand. Lord, I'm tired. I'm tired of suffering day in and day. Lord, I'm tired of working day in and day out. Lord, I'm tired of working myself down to the bone. I'm tired of working from can't see in the morning to can't see at night. Lord, I'm weary and I'm worn. Through the storm, carry me, Lord. Through the night, lead me on until the light. Precious Lord, take my and lead your child on home." God heard the cry of his people. God knew about their struggles. Not only did God know about their struggles and their sorrows, but God said, "Time has come for him to do something about it." Time had come for God to deliver his people out of their wretched situation. But in order for them to walk into the freedom and freedom that God had promised, they must show an unwavering faith in God. It took a great deal of courage for the children of Israel to get up and march up out of Egypt. It took a great deal of courage for them to march out of the bondage in Egypt under the cruel hand of Pharaoh, head to the promised land. Likewise, it took courage for our people to continue to march in the face of racism and bigotry, but they kept marching. In the face of high-powered fire hoses, Martin kept marching. In the face of police billy clubs, Jose Williams kept marching. Andy Young kept marching. They kept marching. John Lewis kept marching. Mega Evers, they kept marching. And I can hear them right now. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Turn me around. I'm gonna keep on walking. Keep on talking. Walking on to freedom's land. Doors of God's church stand open. The doors of God's church stand open. Somebody ought to give their life to Christ today. For those that are online, just simply go to our website, www.arielbowenumc.org. Scroll down to the contact information, and we'll get back with you as soon as possible. If there's trouble in your life, if there's sorrow in your life, if there's a struggle in your life, be rest assured that God hears your cry. God knows about your sorrow. And God is indeed faithful. The doors of God's church stand open. Let us stand.
Praise be to God. Amen. This is not an entertainment program, y'all. This is truly a worship service where we all should come together under God's leadership, under God's guidance, to lift him up, to glorify his name. Don't let nothing or no one stray you from the will of God. Give him the praise while you have the opportunity, because tomorrow might be too late. Everybody ought to feel this way.
I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you. withholding nothing, withholding nothing. I surrender all to you. Everything, Lord, I give to you. Withholding nothing, withholding nothing. Help me choir say, I surrender.
I surrender.
Everybody say that.
All to you.
Everything I give to you.
Everything.
Oh God, it's all belong
I
to you.
Give to you.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
I surrender all to you.
I surrender.
Oh God, it all belongs to you. I give my heart, I give my soul
to you.
Everything I give to you.
Everything.
Oh God.
I give.
Oh yes, Lord.
To you.
Withholding nothing.
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 Oh, I believe that you. I give my heart to you. I give my soul to you.
Everything that I have,
I give it all to you. I give
it all to you.
Everything that I have,
give it all to you.
It belongs to you, Jesus. It belongs to you, Lord.
I give it.
I give it all, I give it all, I give it all.
I give it all.
Oh, give King Jesus, my Savior, forever and ever. I give it all to you.
I give it all to you, I give it all to you, I give it all to you. It belongs to you, Jesus.
Oh, King Jesus. Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing.
Oh, I surrender all.
Yes.
To you. Oh, yes, I do, Lord. Everything.
Everything that I have, Lord, it all belongs to you.
I give to you. Withholding nothing.
Yes, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
What a great word. What a great, great word.
Yes.
I just wanted to remind everyone to stay where you're at. Don't go anywhere. We still have communion, and then we're also going to have our announcements. If you will be taking communion from home, you should have received your elements, and you can do that with us and follow along with us as we take Holy Communion this first Sunday.
Let the church say amen. Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. We do ask that you would gather elements at and we're going to ask our technician if he would place on the board our communion ritual. The great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to our Lord. And so with your people and on earth and all of the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ offering up for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore. Let us repeat the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The same night that our Savior Jesus was betrayed, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them. He broke it. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is the blood of the new covenant, which was shed for you and for the many. Forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you shall. Feed on. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Lord God, we come to you, Lord God, today, not trusting in our own goodness, but Lord, we come trusting in your mercies and manifold goodness for our lives. Lord God, we must confess that we have not been the kind of people that we're supposed to be. We have not sought the needs of those who are needy. We have not been those that have fed those who are hungry. Lord God, we have not brought the water to those that are thirsty. Lord God, we come today asking for your forgiveness. And Lord God, we ask, Lord God, that through these creatures of bread and wine, that you would make them indeed be for us the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that we as a faith community would be the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Redeem us, Lord God, from our sins and our manifold wickedness. Lord God, that we might be made right with you. Lord God, we pray these and all other blessings, Lord God. We pray them in the powerful but precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And let all hearts and all minds say amen. Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. Before he pull up our announcements, we're going to recognize Sister Cassandra. She's helping getting our Black History stuff off the ground. So let's give her a round of applause. We thank her for that. Good to have our musician back with us, our drummer back with us on the drums today. Thank God for him. All right.
I'm your host, Mallory Santiful, and you're tuned into WABUMC, the voice of Ariel Bowen United Methodist Church. Thanks for worshiping here with us at Ariel Bowen United Methodist Church. Bible study is every Wednesday at 12 noon and 6 p.m. via Zoom. The Zoom link will be posted at the end of the announcements. SWAVO, Southwest Atlanta Youth Business Organization, will meet every Monday night at 6 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. The recruit period has started and new students can now sign on. Call Reverend Hope at 404-386-8007. SWAVO teaches youth to organize their own businesses. All members are invited to chat night on Wednesday, February 15th at 6 p.m. The topic and Zoom link will be emailed to all members at a future date. The North Georgia District Training will be held on Saturday, February 18, 2023 at 10 a.m. More information will be sent out at a later date. Ariel Bowen will be fasting and praying together during the Lenten season. We will start off the Lenten season with Ash Wednesday service on Wednesday, February 22nd, 2023. Our own Ricky Bennett will be preaching and we will host his new congregation. During the Lenten season, the congregation will be fasting together. Details on the Daniel fast will be emailed to all members. If there are any organizations that have announcements, please have them in the church office by Wednesday. Thank you again for worshiping with us here at Ariel Bowen United Methodist Church. Just the two
of us. From the first time the doctor placed you in my arms, I knew I'd meet death before I let you meet harm. Although questions arose in my mind, would I be man enough against wrong? Choose right and be standing up from the hospital.
All right, let the church say amen. Let us all stand. Now, I think on next week, we're expecting all of our February birthdays to be here and be in service on that day. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Lord God, as we go forth today, Lord God, we go forth knowing, Lord God, that even in our weary years and even in our silent tears, Lord God, you hear us. Lord God, you know of our pain. And Lord God, as we move through the rest of this month called Black History Month, Lord, let us know that Black history is an integral part of American history. And Lord God, that we are all in this whole thing together, Lord God. And Lord God, we pray that there'll be a day that we won't have to be an African-American History Week or Hispanic Heritage Week, but we all know that we are all God's children, Lord God, and we walk humbly with our God, equally in the sight of God. Lord God, let us go forth with great joy and great peace. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.